You know, this is a big crowd for a Friday afternoon at 4 o'clock. Don't you guys have a social life? Or is all the wine out there? No, I know you came to hear our speaker, Mr. John Sopko, who is the Special Inspector, you can read it right there, Special Inspector General for Afghanistan Reconstruction, SIGAR, as the Pentagon affectionately labels it. It has been for 2 years, and he's going to talk to us about sort of Afghanistan reconstruction and the major impediments to that that emerge out of things like counter-narcotics, corruption, stabilization. Now, I've never been an inspector general. Nobody would ever pick me. I'm just too much of a cream puff for that job. You've got to be tough to be a special inspector general because you're digging into things nobody wants you to know about, right? And in this case, you're not doing it down the street on K Street or in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. You're doing it half a world away and in two different languages. So it wasn't a surprise to me when I went to Mr. Sopko's bio to find that really you've trained for this job pretty much all your life. Now, he's a 1974 graduate from Penn, and I make the point of the date because that means he's a contemporary of Dave Petraeus, Skip Sharp, Keith Alexander, and I think General Dempsey too, right? So it's a great year, something in the air back in 1974, very special. Joined the state prosecutor's office, got a law degree from Case Western Reserve in 77 and went to the state prosecutor's office, but at some point early on, wound up on Capitol Hill where he spent 20 years on both sides of the Hill as the head of investigations for one or another committee or subcommittee. Now I was taken, amused almost, by this one. In his most recent congressional post, he was the chief counsel for oversight and investigations for the House Committee on Energy and Commerce, chaired by John Dingell, who's held that job since the Civil War, and is now stepping down only because his wife's going to get elected to the post. But, you know, when I was writing, I wrote a book on weapons acquisition a long time ago. When Dingell went after you, I have invented a verb, dingleized. You have been dingleized, which is akin to electrocuted. I mean, Dingell was a supreme investigator, and you came later than that, I think, John, but yeah. you don't get hired by John Dingell if you don't know your stuff, and I think that's probably an accolade right there. He also worked with Senator Sam Nunn on the Senate Subcommittee on Investigations, and the list of things he investigated is just too broad to go into it, but it's way beyond national security, a lot of homeland stuff as well. Now, after 20-odd years on the Hill, you won't be surprised. He was recruited by the executive branch, the Secretary of Commerce, to come on over and help them deal with congressional investigations, a shrewd move on the part of the Secretary. Anyway, at some point, after many years in federal service as an investigator, he went to the law firm Aiken Gump, and I think many of you who know the law firms around town know that's one of the most prestigious. He went there in 2009, and it was out of that law firm then that in July of 2012 he was recruited to be the Special Inspector General for Afghanistan Reconstruction. This ought to be really interesting. Thanks so much for joining us, Mr. Rocco, and I'll turn it over to you, 30, 40 minutes, and then we'll have
sure,
a Q&A.
Sure. You can stop me at any time.
I'll see you.
The leg will stop me before you do. Excuse me for a second as I get set up. This is a little, my knee is a little memory from my last visit to Lashkargar, and the an example of the wonderful CH-53, if anybody knows it, and a nice Vietnam-era equipment that the Marines are still using, and they still are leaking hydraulic fluid like crazy. So no change in that. Thank you very much, Dr. McNauer, for that kind introduction. And I want to thank you and your colleagues for inviting me to speak today. I'm always excited to discuss my little agency, SIGAR, and also to talk about reconstruction in Afghanistan, because I think both are very important. But I am really excited today, especially today, since many of you will become the future architects and enablers of foreign policy and national security policies that possibly you may learn something about from my presentation today that may help you in that experience. Since I have the unenviable task of being the last barrier between you and cocktails and the weekend, I will try to be concise in describing some of the lessons we've learned so far in Afghanistan. But please be aware, I am an attorney, former trial attorney, former partner, and I'm used to being paid by the word. So let me start by stating something that's very simple, concise, and to the point. And that is America's investment in Afghanistan has been unprecedented. To date, the United States government has provided over $104 billion for Afghan reconstruction, which has been intended to build the Afghan government, its security forces, bolster Afghanistan's economy, build its infrastructure, expand its health and education sectors, and improve Afghanistan's quality of life and rule of law. Now, that isn't an extraordinary amount of money, but many ways it has gone unnoticed, almost hidden in plain sight. When is the last time you, as students in this area, have heard mention of the massive amount of money being spent on reconstruction in Afghanistan? Or when is the last time you've heard anybody discuss what we have gotten for that investment and what have the Afghans gotten for that investment? Now let's put that figure of $104 billion in some context. And I promise I'm not going to give you some type of comparison between stacking it all up and comparing it to the Washington Monument or going around the world a couple times. Let's just state again a simple fact. That's more money than we have spent on reconstruction for any single country in the history of our republic. More money than we have spent on any single country for reconstruction in the history of our republic. For those of you who are the historians, by the end of this year, we will have spent more money on reconstruction in Afghanistan than we did to rebuild Europe from the Marshall Plan. In relation to current foreign policy hotspots, we're spending more money just this year on reconstruction in Afghanistan than we are on the next four countries combined. That's Israel, Egypt, Pakistan, and Iraq. And as you well know, by December of this year, the president has promised to leave just 9,800 troops in Afghanistan and to reduce it further by December of 2015 to 5,000. As a result, many people believe our involvement in Afghanistan is over or will end at that time. But I urge you to consider that that is a wrong analysis. Despite the drawdown, our reconstruction mission is far from over. And I would say it will probably continue at a high tempo for some years to come if we want to keep the Afghan military and government afloat and we want to protect our reconstruction successes there. In regard to that, right now there is nearly $16 billion in the pipeline, money that Congress has authorized and appropriated, but that U.S. agencies have not yet spent. Now that's right. $16 billion in the bank to be pushed out the door for Afghan reconstruction projects and programs. Furthermore, it is widely believed that the U.S. will continue to fund reconstruction at another $5 to $8 billion a year for the next decade or more. As an example, just last week, the NATO conference in Wales, there, the coalition agreed to fund the Afghan security forces alone at the rate of $5.1 billion a year through 2017. A $1 billion increase in our commitment, with the U.S. shouldering a majority of that funding. It's a tremendous amount of money. Ensuring it's spent correctly and is not only important to the American taxpayer, it is critical to advancing our foreign policy objectives. That is why it's essential that someone is tasked with overseeing this tremendous amount of money and effort. and to ensure that that money is being spent appropriately. And that brings me to my little agency. And the odd little agency with the odd tobacco-flavored acronym, SIGAR. You may not be familiar with SIGAR specifically, and you may not be familiar with inspector generals in general. Don't worry, you're not alone. One of the things that surprised me the most in the 2 years that I have been working as the inspector general is how little people in the Department of Defense, Department of State, and AID understand the role of not only SIGAR, but inspectors general. I was stunned when on my first trip to Kabul, after being on the job for a few months, senior officials at the State Department officials on that first trip suggested how they should write our reports. They even suggested changes to our report titles and proposed we give them our press releases first in advance so they could pre-approve them. Little did they know that the law that created the Inspector General community in 1978 declared that IGs were to be independent of the agencies. And little did they know that the specific legislation that created SIGAR made us more independent than most inspector generals. So let me take a moment now, particularly for those of you who are going to follow the career in the Foreign Service and National Security, to talk a little bit about my agency, the role of inspector generals in foreign policy and in national security, and how this little shop, SIGAR, is different than the 72 other statutory IGs in the federal government that you may have run into. As I mentioned, Congress created SIGAR in 2008 to provide, quote, independent and objective oversight of the U.S. reconstruction effort in Afghanistan. After broad, long, and public dissatisfaction by Congress about the performance of the first Special Inspector General, President Obama appointed me to lead the agency and succeed him in 2012. It was, and I want to make that important too. My Inspector General, my predecessor, was basically driven from office because he wasn't aggressive enough, because he didn't do the job that Congress wanted. IGs are very public. And I don't know if any of you have ever thought of being a trial attorney. It's very similar to that. If you screw up in public. And so that's something to keep in mind. And I remember once telling some general who was huffing and puffing about one of my reports. And I said, General, if you want to know why we're so aggressive, I highly recommend you go on the web and check Senator McCaskill's hearing on what the demise of my predecessor. And now you can know why we are so aggressive. But let me just tell you, it is my job, and it is the job of my 200 auditors, investigators, inspectors, and other officials to ensure that that unprecedented $104 billion investment is protected from waste, fraud, and abuse. Like any inspector general, we issue audits and reports highlighting the problems we find, make recommendations wherever we can, and arrest criminals, because we have law enforcement authority, who steal from the U.S. government. Our mission is clearly stated in our authorizing statute to keep the president, the administration, and Congress, quote, fully and currently informed about problems and deficiencies, unquote, in the Afghan reconstruction effort. I'll note, and I highly recommend you to read our authorization statute if you're interested. You will find no language in that authorization statute saying I should be a cheerleader for reconstruction in Afghanistan. And I should highlight successes on reconstruction in Afghanistan. Now, I'm happy to do so when we do find such successes, but it's not the requirement and not the mandate of an inspector general. Moreover, SIGAR is different than other inspector generals in four key areas. First, we're temporary. We go out of existence. And I believe we should go out of existence when the time is right, as it's established by statute. This we are required by law to wind down our operations once the balance of undisbursed funds for Afghan reconstruction falls below $250 million. Now remember, I said before, there's $16 billion in the pipeline that still hasn't been disbursed, and promises of $5 billion to $8 billion, so we could be around for a while. But nevertheless, I realize there is an end date. Accordingly, unlike many other agencies and other inspector generals, time is of the essence for my office and my responsibilities. The second thing, while IGs are an independent lot, you could say that SIGAR, to use a phrase of the younger generation, is maybe an uber independent agency. That is, we are not housed in any federal agency. I'm not like the DOD IG and DOD or the AID IG or the state IG in those specific agencies. We sit uber above those agencies to look at reconstruction. The third point which makes us different than any other agency is we are not, again, tied to an agency. We are looking at broad interagency missions of reconstruction. Congress gave SIGAR blanket authority to examine any and all reconstruction activities, regardless of what U.S. agency is involved. Fourth, and I think this is a key, SIGAR, unlike any other department or agency in the government, is mandated to specifically examine multi-jurisdictional programs, policies, and problems. This is significant, particularly for those of you interested in conflict zones. Because in Afghanistan, as well as any other future conflict zone, federal agencies must work together to tackle key problems. So let me be clear about this. Only SIGAR, the only little agency in the government, is mandated by statute to assess these interagency efforts and make recommendations on what I would call the whole of government approach to reconstruction in a conflict environment. Now that you know who we are, let me focus on three major interagency challenges we think are critical for reconstruction success. There's sustainability, corruption, and narcotics trafficking. Development experts have told me repeatedly and told our staff that reconstruction programs must take into account a recipient country's ability to operate and sustain the assistance provided. If they don't, we put the programs and tax dollars at risk. Likewise, there is no benefit from the reconstruction if we set up programs and projects that the Afghans cannot or will not sustain once our forces depart and international aid declines. Unfortunately, what we have found is Afghanistan is a case study in projects and programs set up without considering ultimate sustainability. The sheer size of the U.S. government's reconstruction effort in such a small and poor country as Afghanistan has placed both a financial and operational burden on the Afghan economy, government, and people that they simply cannot manage on their own. For example, last year the Afghan government raised approximately $2 billion in revenue, legally raised in revenue. They collected some revenue illegally on our government contractors, but we'll not discuss that. Next year, they hope to raise approximately $2.4 billion. That's their plan. But recent studies we've received said they're not going to come nowhere near that. The problem is their stated budget requirement is approximately $7.6 billion. Do you see the delta? Unfortunately, the Afghan government will not be able to meet its budget without continued and significant donor assistance. Currently, the United States and international donors fund approximately 60% of the Afghan budget, as well as countless reconstruction programs and projects currently operating off budget. With the troop withdrawal, greater responsibility for those off budget programs and projects will have to be given to the Afghan government. Let's look at the ANSF, the Afghan National Security Forces, and see clearly why this is going to be an immense problem. The latest independent assessment by the Center for Naval Analysis concludes that the ANSF will require a force of 373,000. That will cost roughly $5 to $6 billion per year. Remember, they raise revenue of only $2 billion per year. Do you see the delta? Do you see the problem? At these levels, if the Afghan government were to dedicate all of its domestic revenue towards sustaining their army and police, they still could only pay for one-third of the cost, approximately. Moreover, all other costs, from paying civil servants, teachers, maintaining roads, schools, hospitals, and any other non-military infrastructure, would definitely have to come from other international donors, or would have to end. The bottom line is, it appears we've created a government that the Afghans simply cannot afford. Accordingly, when we build things that the Afghans can't use, and when we don't take their resources into account, we're not just wasting money, we're jeopardizing our mission. And remember, our mission was to create a self-sustaining Afghanistan that can keep insurgents down and terrorists out. That's why sustainability must be an essential factor in any decision-making about projects going forward. We must make sure we are not building a system that will collapse once we leave. Now, corruption is another enormous interagency challenge facing reconstruction in Afghanistan. The consensus among everyone I speak with is if corruption is allowed to continue unabated, it will likely jeopardize every gain we've made so far in Afghanistan. Because corruption destroys the populace's confidence in their elected officials. It siphons off funds that would be used to combat insurgents or build infrastructure, and ultimately leads to a government that is ineffectual and distrusted. The threat from unabated corruption is especially exemplified this week, in the last few weeks, in light of the ongoing election crisis you have been reading about. A crisis spawned from corruption, which many fear is putting Afghanistan's future, its entire future, in jeopardy. Now, the problem of corruption isn't new. Experts and SIGAR have been highlighting concerns about corruption for a long time. Top U.S. officials are aware of the problem. Just last year, a report commissioned by General Dunford noted, quote, corruption directly threatens the viability and legitimacy of the Afghan state, unquote. USAID's own administrator for Afghanistan and Pakistan, Larry Sampler, testified at a hearing with me that Afghanistan's, quote, is the most corrupt place I've ever been to, unquote, said Mr. Sampler. And retired Marine Corps General John Allen, the former head of ISAF, identified in hearing testimony last year that corruption is a bigger threat than the Taliban and the insurgents in Afghanistan. The Afghans themselves are concerned about corruption. In June, Integrity Watch Afghanistan, an Afghan NGO, which is well-respected, issued their latest national corruption survey. It found that corruption tied for second as the greatest challenge facing Afghans after security. While 18% of the respondents in 2012 said they had faced corruption within the last 12 months, that had increased to 21% by the 2014 survey. The survey also noted that the Afghans believed corruption in most public sectors undermined their access to services, the same services the U.S. government and our allies have invested billions of dollars to establish. In June, the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace singled out Afghanistan as a clear example of a state where governing systems had been bent to benefit one or a few networks of highly placed rich individuals. According to that report, President Karzai regularly calls his attorney general to influence cases or personally orders the release of suspects from pretrial detention, quashing the cases against him. Now remember, this is the same attorney general who just recently threw out a respected New York Times reporter out of the country because he didn't like his reporting. SIGAR has issued a number of reports on U.S. efforts to combat corruption. I wish I could say something positive about that in those reports, but unfortunately I can't. These reports have continually pointed out that the United States lacks a unified anti-corruption strategy in Afghanistan. This is astonishing, given that Afghanistan has historically been listed as one of the most corrupt countries in the world, and it is one of the countries we are spending so many billions of dollars. Yet there has been no progress made over the last 2 years to developing a unified anti-corruption strategy. And in fact, we believe things will get worse only as the drawdown continues in the troops. We cannot shy away from the challenge of corruption. We need a strategy, and we need to hold the Afghans' feet to the fire on this issue. It takes two to tango here. SIGAR will continue to point out how well or poorly not only U.S. officials, but also Afghan officials perform in their promise, and they made promises at Tokyo and Chicago and elsewhere, to fight corruption, but they haven't lived up to them. Now, directly tied to corruption is the final interagency challenge I wanted to talk about today, and that is countering the growth of the drug trade in Afghanistan. This challenge is no secret to anyone who has studied Afghanistan. The United States has already spent nearly $7.6 billion to combat the opium trade. And I have to report, as I did to Congress, that using any and every conceivable metric, we have failed. Production is up. Cultivation is up. Interdiction is down. Eradication is down. Financial support to the insurgency is up. Addiction is up. Drug abuse is up. Crime is up related to Afghanistan. Now, I've been looking at counter-narcotics policy since 1982. And I go back to the days of Benzinger at the old before pre-DEA. And he said, look at mortality, morbidity, arrests, all those standards. You apply every one of them, we have failed. In the opinion of almost everyone I've met, every expert I've talked to, everyone except some of the talking heads in the embassy, they've all told me that the counter-narcotics situation in Afghanistan is dire with little prospect for improvement. As with sustainability and corruption, the expanding cultivation and trafficking of drugs puts the entire Afghan reconstruction effort at risk. The narcotics trade poisons the Afghan financial sector, fuels an illicit economy, and this in turn undermines Afghanistan's state's legitimacy by stoking again corruption, nourishing criminal networks, and providing significant financial support to the Taliban and other insurgent groups. There are already signs that have been reported publicly in the press about Afghan security forces reaching arrangements with drug traffickers on the growing of crops and the sharing of the money to build local patronage networks and generate illicit income for them. Given the importance of this problem, I was astonished and have been astonished over the last year to find out that the counter-narcotics effort is not a top priority of the U.S. government or our allies. And especially during this critical transition period, it has fallen off the map. For example, the latest U.S. civil military strategic framework for Afghanistan, which articulates the vision for pursuing U.S. national goals in Afghanistan, barely mentions narcotics for its first time. And when I have met with Department of Justice, State Department, and DOD officials, none of them, to a man and woman, have been able to convincingly explain to me how the U.S. counter-narcotics efforts are making a meaningful impact on the narcotics trade in Afghanistan, or how they'll have a significant impact after the 2014 transition. Now that is troubling. Without an effective counter-narcotic strategy and an Afghan political will to tackle this problem, Afghanistan may well be on the road to become a narco-criminal state in the very near future. Now, these challenges are real. And I cannot deny to you that they are difficult. These aren't easy. If they were easy, we probably would have fixed them. But they are not insurmountable. The problem is, they will never be solved if we do not first acknowledge the problem, expose them, and make their elimination through oversight mission critical, to use a military term for the utmost priority we must place on efforts. That means having people at all levels working to ensure that we're getting what we paid for, that our programs work as intended, and that we're realistically planning for the realities on the ground. By making oversight not only a component in every program and project, but a mission-critical component, we will help ensure that our efforts result in more success and less waste. I want to take an audit we did as an example. We audited DOD's basing plans for the Afghan National Security Forces. This shows what I mean about mission-critical. That one audit saved $500 million because we exposed and identified areas where there was a duplication and unnecessary expenditure. Why it became mission critical is that the officers and generals in the field grabbed that report and ran with it, and the issue had been erased, they were aware of it, and they diligently cut even more unnecessary basing projects and programs, saving the taxpayer and saving our reconstruction effort millions of dollars. Now, cost savings are not the only reason oversight should be mission critical. When we build a school whose roof falls down, or a hospital without electricity and running water, or a prison where you can walk through the bars because it's so poorly constructed, we're not just wasting money, we're putting lives at risk and jeopardizing our effort to win the hearts and minds of the Afghan citizens in our war against terrorism. It's not just the lives and well-beings of Afghans, though, that are on the line when oversight is not a priority. It also endangers Americans and coalition lives. For example, in the military's effort to protect our troops from IEDs, there was an effort made to, we paid contractors to install culvert denial systems on roads so they couldn't place bombs there. Well, we have an investigation ongoing, and unfortunately it appears a number of U.S. servicemen were killed. Now, I can't go into the details of it, but apparently there was a problem with oversight and a problem of holding the contractors accountable. So oversight is not just an important component. As I said, it must be mission critical, because without oversight, without effective oversight, fraud will kill. Now clearly, if you hear this, I figure this is an upbeat presentation, you guys, allows you to drink. I think. It's my Slavic background. I'll always be depressed, and then you can go have alcohol. Clearly, much needs to change in our approach to Afghanistan reconstruction. The hundreds of audits, inspections, investigations of SIGAR and my oversight colleagues at GAO and the other agency IGs describe a litany of problems and mistakes. I could go on and on. But how do you affect change? And this is what's important for you. It'll be your job to affect change in bureaucracies such as DOD, state, and aid. It is possible. But one thing is sure, nothing will change if you don't publicize the problems. And that's the mantra I am going to keep banging on. It is something you have to keep in mind. As I've learned from 30 plus years here in Washington, for change to happen, problems need to be placed under the public spotlight. It's the foundation of oversight and good governance. Remember, your mother probably taught you this, sunlight is the best disinfectant. In January 2009, I believe the reason President Obama issued the memorandum to the heads of agencies about transparency was because he believed it too. Because he said that government should be transparent because, quote, transparency promotes accountability and provides information for citizens about what their government is doing, unquote. We at SIGAR entirely support that presumption of openness in federal policy that flowed from the president's memo. Now, the president's view on transparency is not new, but flows in itself from the 1966 Freedom of Information Act, the 1978 Inspector General Act that I alluded to, and SIGAR's own authorization language. Transparency and openness are vital to good government. It does not take a rocket scientist to know that opaque surfaces polished by agency PR staff can conceal problems and provide false assurances that everything is fine. And you don't have to be Inspector Clouseau or particularly suspicious to think that agency heads may not always be inclined to call attention to problems within their agency, whether it's an IG report or not, that exposes it. Now you understand, if you have been following SIGAR and done some due diligence on me and my agency, why SIGAR reports have been in the news since I took over the agency 2 years ago. It was not an accident. It was intentional. As policy, we publish, post, tweet, and otherwise publicize virtually everything we do. Now, not everyone is happy with that approach to oversight. But the way I view it is I was appointed by the president, and if he is not happy, he can always replace me. But up to now, I think everyone's been happy with what we're doing. Except, I must say, there are some ambassadors and generals and nameless, faceless bureaucrats and contractors unhappy with the fact we get such press coverage. They even complain that we have a press shop. All two people. Now, our press shop kind of pales with two people in comparison with the squadrons of PR people at Embassy Kabul. I think they have over 60. ISAF, I think it's in the hundreds. And the Pentagon, God, you could have a division of PR people in the Pentagon. But yet, they are afraid of my two press people. And every time my press people hear that, they ask for a raise, so it's been very expensive. What they don't understand is publicity and transparency is the cost of open democratic government. Now, some people also think we do this to gratify our own egos. They are mistaken. I'm not angling for another government job. I realize this is my last. It's also been my best. I've enjoyed this the most. I'm not angling for a movie role or a book advance or trying to become your next YouTube sensation. The need to publicly highlight management problems is something I learned, and it was alluded to by the professor when he introduced me. I learned from great congressional oversight leaders that I had the great privilege to work for. Leaders such as Sam Nunn, Bill Roth, John Gillette. Warren Rudman and Carl Levin, as well as Congressman John Beagle and Henry Waxman. From these statesmen, and that's something you have to realize, we had statesmen. We still do, but not as many as when I started, and I hope you had the opportunity to work for statesmen like I did. From these statesmen, I learned the following basic principle, which has guided my work on the Hill as well as SIGAR. And that is that unless it's a security risk or classified, you publish the work you're doing at SIGAR. And if it's worth publishing, it's worth publicizing. And if it's worth publishing and worth publicizing, it's worth repeatedly doing it to get the message across and to effect change. I recall for John Dingell, when he was chairman of the Energy and Commerce Committee, I did 16 investigative hearings on food safety because John Dingell knew if you were going to get a good food safety law, you had to repeatedly identify the problem. SIGAR welcomes publicity because publicity gives our reports and work impact, whether it's in Washington, Kabul, or around the world, as indicated when I talked to my NATO friends. I suggest to you that very few Americans have read the Health and Human Services IG report on billing fraud against Medicare for motorized wheelchairs. But I bet you millions of people have had the chance to read the Washington Post 4,000-word story from August 16th that dramatized and humanized the problem. Likewise, I doubt any of you have read the VAIG reports, but people know about those problems and the problems at those hospitals because they publicized it and the reporters publicized it repeatedly. Those are the kind of stories that get attention. Editorial writers, ordinary citizens, congressional staff, think tank researchers pick up on such revelations and weigh in. Members of Congress call hearings. They draft legislation. Agency heads eagerly or reluctantly draft responses, policies, and testimonies. With any luck, things get better, whether systematically or a bit at a time. Let's face it, and you're going to have to face it as you begin or continue your careers in the government. No matter how good an IG audit, GAO report, commission finding, or university research study may be, if it falls into the black hole of background noise in Washington, it will go unnoticed and it will help no one. It will not lead to change. It will not lead to improvements. It will not make the government better and programs better and will not help our society. We believe the widespread dissemination of IG reports promotes a number of good outcomes. Publicity brings problems to the attention of senior leaders whose information gatekeepers may not have relayed such unwelcome news. Publicity motivates people to do the right thing, whether sharpening their own performance or calling out problems. Publicity may prompt managers to take corrective actions before they get a nasty memo from the boss. Publicity can deter government contractors from cutting corners or using substandard materials if they fear they may be caught and have to pay a fine, become debarred, or get indicted. Publicity can therefore deter fraud. When potential wrongdoers read about a federal civilian employee, military member, or contractor going to jail and paying big fines for taking kickbacks or bribes, they may decide not to give in to the temptation. As I learned as a federal and state prosecutor, you really do get the attention of somebody really quick once you indict them. Publicity can encourage people to come forward to the IG community. Some of our best tips and other information have come from senior officials, including generals and ambassadors, once they read about us in the press. Publicity also can point out successes and best practices and then encourage people to do a better job by following the performance measures of others who have succeeded. And finally, and perhaps most importantly, publicizing our work gives American taxpayers and congressional appropriators confidence that someone appointed by the President of the United States is looking out for how their money is spent. As our friends in the armed services would say, publicity is a force multiplier. So in conclusion, and I know it's been long and I promise to let you get to the alcohol sooner than later. We have a lot of work ahead of us. You may have a lot of work ahead of us. Some of you may be working in agencies. Actually, a number of your colleagues before you are actually working for my agency now. But working on reconstruction, whether it's working for an IG or contractor, or Department of Defense, or whatever, is going to be increasingly dangerous and even more difficult. It is a real challenge. We are here to help. I know that sounds odd.
I'm from Washington. I'm here to help you.
From the IRS, I'm here to help you. We are. That's our own mission. As I told the White House when I was appointed, or I was under consideration, I don't need this job to kill trees. I'm happy what I'm doing right now. I'm actually making more money when I was a partner in a law firm. I took this job, and the people who are working for me have taken the job to change. We're change artists. And I hope you become a change artist as you start or continue your career. Because we need to change. We at SIGAR are change artists, but we support the mission. Our mission in Afghanistan. We all want reconstruction to succeed in creating a stable and sustainable economy and government in Afghanistan. But we want our government to do it better. In addition, we at SIGAR and the other oversight colleagues I have a different role in that mission than those in the implementing agencies. And it's right that there is a different role. We are like the referee. That referee you see on Sunday night or Monday night football, who's throwing the flag. But just because we're the referee and we're throwing the flag, the penalty flag, doesn't mean we don't support the success of the sport or the success of the game any more than the players or the fans in the stadium. So that concludes my remarks. I'm sorry if they went longer than I thought. But I'm happy to answer any questions or whatever.
Thank you.
Sure. Let me get some help.
Okay. I thought that was cool. I don't think you'll have trouble hearing either one of us without the microphone somehow. And I wanted to just take the moderator's prerogative and a little bit of an unfair question because you're spotting corruption. I went to a conference a couple of years ago, and Richard Armitage, former Deputy Secretary of State, said, you know, he went around the world with highlighting all the conflict zones. But in the end, he said, you know, if I had a dollar, I'd invested in anti-corruption. That's the biggest security problem out there. So the obvious follow-on question is, okay, Mr. Deputy Secretary, what do you put your dollar in? And I wonder, you know, you're spotting corruption, and that's your job, but do you have just from seeing so much of it, do you have an idea, if you had $1 billion to fight corruption, what would you do with it?
Yeah, I mean, a very good question, and apropos of your colleague here who worked for General Petraeus. There were some lessons learned from Iraq. And early on, the generals in Afghanistan said, we got to focus on corruption. And they created a number of task forces and organizations to look at contracting and trying to focus on corruption and focus on keeping bad players out. And so I would put money in that. Unfortunately, over time, the great ideas of General Petraeus and some of the other generals, that General Allen also, it got sort of lost in the shuffle. And there is always a tendency that counterterrorism will trump corruption. And you're always going to run against that. But I go back to say I would put my money in that. I would also put my money in the designing programs to protect them from the corrupt influence. And that is, we knew we were going to the most corrupt country in the world. But we didn't really design our programs. And there are some foreign countries, and that are smaller than us, some of the European countries actually design their programs because they know where they're going. And that was a problem, I think. I would put money into that. I would put money into oversight. I mean, we get a big bang for our buck, and I forget what the number is. You can check our quarterly report. I don't know how many dollars you get for every dollar investment. But unfortunately, by the time we show up, we're like your police show on TV where the guy comes up and you find the body with a chonk around it. It's dead. The money's stolen. You know, the money's gone. The money's in Dubai, you know, and we're not going to get it back. But I would put money in planning for this, designing programs for this, and I would put money, less money, and more on holding people's feet to the fire. This is where I go back to CT always trumps anti-corruption. And that's a mistake. We always think, ooh, if we're not nice, they won't take our money. My God, you know what it was like. It was easier if we had actually forced the issues back then. And that's what people tell me. I wasn't in Afghanistan when your colleague here was. But we had better leverage back then, more leverage, I should say, than maybe we do now. And we could have held feet to the fire, and I don't think we did. And that's a big problem, because when you don't do that, then Katie barred a door. It's just the snowball rolling down the hill and just picking up and getting worse and worse. And then they know that we will never really walk away. And that's the big problem. So it's not so much the money. I think it's an attitude to how you deal with the corrupt people.
One thing you said was, these have to be customized to the place you're going. You can't just have a general...
Absolutely.
Okay, listen, I'll call on people. When I call on you, please stand up. Tell us if you're, associated with SSP, SFS, or where you're working, and then just speak loudly enough so that we can all hear you. Yeah.
Hi, my name is Alvin Sari, a recent graduate from Yale's graduate school. My question is, one of your counterparts, Stuart Bowen, from the Inspector General from Iraq, after his experience, he proposed a bill called Sopko, which is a civilian department which would be independent, that deals with reconstruction and would avoid interagency problems of the state and defense. I was wondering what your opinion on this approach was and whether U.S. reconstruction capacity is sufficient on its own. And the second question is historical. I like history a lot. I think William Taft did a great job at reconstruction. Do you think anybody's kind of...
William Taft? Yeah. President Taft?
Yeah. No. Oh, that...
President Taft?
Oh, I thought it was more recent, the fourth.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
because he used to be the Governor General of the Philippines.
Yeah. I don't know. There were some problems.
You don't know that story? What's wrong with you?
Okay.
And so it's just a historical question about the United States' ability to reconstruct. Do you think it's kind of been under decline since then? And if so, maybe would like a USOCO type bill be a step in the right direction?
Yeah, I haven't spent a lot of time looking at USOCO. I know Stuart, and I know his reports, and I know he pushed that. I don't really think it is necessary, but I know where he's getting at. It's a frustration that we have. And it's something that General Allen, last time I talked to him, mentioned. And this is this whole of government approach. And General Allen's sharp on this. And he said, look, the military will do lessons learned. They know how to do that. Right? They've been doing it for years and, probably going back to George Washington. They write it, they put it in, it gets informed into their doctrine. If you want to advance in the military as a general officer, you're going to be going to these schools, you'll be trained on those lessons learned. He said, so the Army will do that, the Navy will do that, Marines, the Air Force will do it. He says, is the state doing it? Does the State Department even have a process to do lessons learned? I don't know. But we're looking into it. He said, does USAID have it? Do they do lessons learned? Now, we found a great lessons learned report done by USAID, and I highly recommend it. You seem like a history buff. You would love it. You can find it on our website. They did a report back in 1988, and it's on lessons learned on USAID reconstruction in Afghanistan from like 1957 to 1979.
Wow.
We found the report. I could not find one individual in USAID who had ever read it. I could find no individuals in the State Department training school who ever used it. I have talked to individuals, and we're going to be looking at this. We're talking to individuals who over at the State Department Training School see, what type of training do you do to foreign service officers? I know you do language. You get a course on culture. But do you ever do lessons learned? Is there a body of lessons learned? So what Alan was saying to us, the general, said, look at, and he's the one who reminded me, and that's why I said in his speech, he says, you look at your legislation, you're the only agency in the government who's supposed to do this. Look at all of the government agencies and do those lessons learned of how we do this again, because it'll be a whole of government approach. So I think we need to do those lessons learned
before I would recommend a USOCO or whatever. Politically, I think during that time, I don't think USOCO had much of a chance. I don't think people in hell were really interested in creating another bureaucracy. And that's always a problem. There's always a question of creating just another bureaucracy. But the problem will be when there is another one of these things, and there will be. I hear they're already planning in Syria. You know, what will happen? What's going to happen? We're going to have to do reconstruction. There's shooting going on. Okay, who's going to do it? Who's going to build that bridge? Who's going to get the money out there? Is it going to be state or aid? No, because they don't have the budget, they don't have the staffing, they don't have the manpower. The military will be the only option. And I think there are many generals in this town who have looked at this issue and say, that's not right. You know, as one general told me, I'm not going to make his name, he says, we're good at breaking things. We're not really great at building things. And he said, you know, you got to really think. And this goes back to USOCO in a way, but not directly, is that you really have to make certain everybody can show up and at the plate, at the table, and they can do something. The problem is only the military can call up a guard unit or reserve unit. You need people to do hospitals? We got a guard unit in Iowa. We'll send it there. You need 1,000 people to build roads? We got guard units. We can bring them in. Where's state? Where's aid? It's very difficult for them. And I don't mean it as a criticism. It's really something Congress should consider. You know, and maybe from our reports we'll talk into that. But it's a broader issue, I think.
Yep, right here.
Hi, Jeannie. I just recently graduated from London School of Economics. I just had a quick question. On page 10 of your quarterly report, you say that exports were higher before the Taliban.
Exports were what?
Before the fall of the Taliban, exports were higher in Afghanistan than they are today. But I saw on your Twitter account recently that you corrected. Is that true?
I don't know the reference you're talking about. Exports were higher.
Exports.
Oh,
exports.
Oh, yeah. We relied on a study that, excuse me for a second, I'm just getting some more water. We relied on a study that a lot of the other government agencies did, and they then got back to us. I think we cite it in there, and we say, they came back and said, whoops, we made a mistake. So we've corrected that. I think we've corrected it online. I don't think we obviously we can't correct it in the print edition. Yeah. Yes. Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah. I'm Mike Meese. I'm a professor here in the Security Studies program, actually teaching a new course called The Economics of War. So among other things, we're reading about these kinds of reconstruction efforts with a lot of the graduate students here. And I like your perspective sort of on the history that you've had looking at inspections and having benefited from reading a lot of the investigations and inspections that have been in government in the 70s and the 80s, and I kind of agree with you that there seem to be fewer statesmen. I don't know whether it's history, you only see that. And if next week there's a hearing on corruption in Afghanistan, down the hallway there's a hearing on the NFL's handling of Ray Rice, the amount of attention and cameras and publicity is going to be very disproportional between the two, in spite of the fact that our taxpayers are spending billions of dollars. And I wonder if there's, from a government kind of perspective, if I applaud your presentation and your publicity that you're doing, more than, again, probably equal to that of Stuart Bowen, who really paved the way of getting the word out about with SIGAR, his role as Special Inspector General. But what is there that can be done, or is there observations from a political science good government perspective to address getting back to the kinds of inspections that you grew up with?
You know, there's a broader question about oversight on the Hill, oversight in the press. I mean, there's a lot of economic, political things moving through that, you know, are hard to explain. I mean, you look at when I got started, you had, and I got my start looking at organized crime, actually. and every major newspaper in the United States had a reporter who covered organized crime. And then they had a reporter that covered labor racketeering organized crime. I mean, you had reporters doing that, and the economy has changed. You don't have that. Likewise, and so I don't have an answer to that. And likewise on the Hill, and maybe because of 24-hour news cycles, it's hard to do 16 hearings on one issue. But it's not impossible. And even in the heyday of Oversight on the Hill, you would always have the glamour boys. I used to call people investigations. They were the rip and tear investigations. That means your boss rips something out of the morning newspaper, and now it's probably an email clip or something like that, runs in and he's tearing his ass, gives it to you, and I don't want to hear it tomorrow. Well, you're not going to do much oversight in 24 hours or 48 hours or 2 weeks here. But those are rip and tears. There always were rip and tears. And even in the heyday of oversight, we had the McCarthy Committee. We had HUAC. We had a lot of bad investigations and oversight going on. And you always had to confront the human nature that, you know, who wants to talk about Afghanistan? I prefer to talk about boxing or sports or whatever. But that means it's just a little difficult. It doesn't mean it's impossible. And good statesmen and good investigators and good reporters and good people who are focusing on it know you got to work around. It's not easy. As I used to teach a course over at American University on congressional oversight, I used to start off by saying every congressman and every congressional committee can do oversight. Few do, and even fewer do it well. And that's because people haven't taken the time to learn it. It's not something you just, I'm a congressman, I'm going to do an oversight hearing because my staff has told me how to read somebody, you know, swear them in. It takes time. It takes effort. You have to spend the time and the effort. You have to educate yourself, and if you're interested in it, you have to educate people in Congress and people in the government how to do it the right way. But I don't see any problem with this. It's not easy. If it was easy, we would have the problems fixed. There would be no ISIS. There'd be no fraud and corruption. You know, we'd have the answer to the common cold, too. But anyway.
You know, in retirement, consider a book.
No. You got to write a book.
I can't
write
it there.
Yeah.
Professor, good afternoon. I'm Wani from Afghanistan. Before I began to be a live discussion today on my office, and it was interesting for me to have the friends who you and others here in this talk about the corruption. Why I so interested to talk about this issue? Because I worked for 4 years with the anti-corruption department in Afghanistan. It was with the name of Hayats of Oversight and Anti-Corruption. It would first correct me that Afghanistan is not a corrupted country. If you are talking about the administration, yes, the administration or current administration has its problems. And corruption is not only one side, it has always two sides. If on the one side is the government, on the other side there might be the farmers or the foreign country. I remember that in 2010, I attended one of the events which was in Singapore. It was about the anti-corruption means how to fight against this phenomenon. Over there, the first is we asked them that how you guys could finally tackle the corruption or finally anti-corruption. They said this is not easy deal. It needs time, needs more patience. They said that we could finally curb the corruption after 50 years. If we say that we eradicate corruption, it is totally wrong. If we say that we can control, then that's correct. So, I remember when I was with that department.
There's going to have to be a question here at some point. I don't mean to cut you off, but we only have time for one lecture. And what you're saying is important, but not tonight.
The second part, I just want to say a bit with the
gentleman. Well, not much. Okay.
Get the point. When I was over there, I didn't see any memorandum of understanding. Interior Department needs to fight against corruption jointly. Why? This has never happened over here. Means to.
Let me try to answer that question. First of all, we do try to work with the Attorney General. Even the Attorney General, who I mentioned and everyone's been very critical about, and who I think maybe in a way frustrated some of the efforts when he worked there. We're actually the only U.S. law enforcement agency that has worked with the Attorney General in prosecuting some cases. And there's a very decent, honest, brave prosecutors and policemen in Afghanistan who we have worked with. And we are the only government agency who has actually had a U.S. federal employee, one of our agents, testify in Afghan court. It's the first. But even those prosecutors and police we deal with, they tell us, and we appreciate it, that they can only go so far, and there's a problem with it. So we don't have an official memorandum, because if we do it, we have to officially deal with the Attorney General's office itself, and we don't think we can accomplish much by that, nor has anybody else in our government felt that they can accomplish much with dealing with the Attorney General. But we at lower levels, out in the field, we have done that. And some of our law enforcement, other partners, DEA in particular, have agreements with certain organizations in Afghanistan. Let me make one point, and I think it is one point that I know you're getting at, and I don't want to leave this misconception. Not that the Afghans are inherently corrupt. And I don't mean to leave it. I don't mean to insult the Afghan nation and the Afghan people. As one presidential candidate told me, and I won't mention his name, he said, when I was in New York, I remember seeing a Brinks truck overturned and the back door opened up and dollars and bills floated around in downtown Manhattan. And he said, and on the news were Americans running around trying to catch dollar bills. He says, does that mean Americans are inherently corrupt? He says, look what you did to my country. You opened the spigot and you poured billions of dollars in one of the poorer countries in the world with no oversight, with no control, and you wonder why we're running around trying to capture the money? We haven't seen this much money in life. You've distorted our economy. You distorted many of our systems of government, many of our social systems. So you're absolutely correct. It takes two to tango. We have contributed to the corruption problem, and I think my office realizes it, and I think a lot of people in the United States. The problem is, you should have thought about that. If you spend too much money in too small a country with too little oversight, you're going to have a disaster. And that's what we have in Afghanistan. It's not just the Afghans' fault.
There was a hand way back in the back, yeah. We have two more questions, I think. Is that, I think the wine is calling. Yeah, go ahead.
Hi, my name is Amanda Shaw. I'm a doctorate candidate at the University of Oxford. I just was hoping you could talk a little bit more about interagency coordination and the reconstruction efforts. As you mentioned, there's a lot of competing objectives between development, defense, and probably with allocation of funding and a lot of internal politics between those agencies. What have you sort of seen and what would you recommend to fix some of the problems or perhaps to realize a bit more potential from the sort of whole government approach to reconstruction?
Yeah, I'm not going to try to be cute on this thing. We actually have a lessons learned report. We're going to be looking at that whole issue, so I don't want to bias them in any way, and I'll wait till after they do that report. But we've seen a lot of problems with cooperation inside the U.S. government as well as with our allies and then with the Afghans. So, I mean, I'll just say that. Mechanisms have been set up, but a lot of times it was pro forma. The classic case, and I had a senior official at USAID out in Afghanistan come to me and say, hey, look, the military had their CERT funding, they built all these bridges, we don't know anything about them. Next thing we know, they call us up and say, hey, here's the bridge, it's all yours, finish it, bye. Really, what kind of, cooperation was that? Or we're trying to get together to do something on a project, and aid starts the project and leaves, and the Corps of Engineers doesn't even know it's being done, so that happens all the time. everybody is, we feel, have left the Afghans out of the picture. We hear a lot from the Afghans saying the first time we hear about the clinic or the police station or whatever is when somebody gives us the keys. And we've identified that in a number of reports. And it's something you really got to do. We need to have better coordination. We need to ask the Afghans, what do they want? What do they need first? Not saying we have to listen to that always, because sometimes they need, you know, they want intercontinental ballistic missiles or whatever. I mean, you know, sometimes you got to put a, you know, hold the bag. But we really need to bring everybody in the tent. And there's serious problems with us and the allies. And let me give you just one more example. I know he and everybody else wants to drink, but I can tell you some of these stories over alcohol. But you get into, I need one for this leg, to be honest. You know, you get into the situation we found out about UNDP, UN Development Goal. UNDP. And it has to do with LOTFA, the Law Enforcement Trust Fund, where we pay the salaries of all the police. We're doing an investigation, and I'm going around talking to people, and we find out from the Europeans that the EU has withheld $200 or $300 million, and this is a trust fund run by the UN, to pay the police salaries. They have $200, $300 million they've withheld because they've done an audit of UNDP and found out that there's ghost workers. Now, we, the U.S. government, through CSTICA, are also funding that. So I go to CSTICA, and they said, what report? What audit? They didn't know anything about it. So here you have multiple agencies, governments, contributing to the UN, and nobody's talking to each other. And actually, when we go over and talk to the EU and talk to NATO, they're happy to hear from us, because many times the only time they know what even the EU, what our government is doing, or whatever, is when they talk to us. So we're bridging that gap, and that shouldn't be. We, again, by the time the IGs come in, the body is cold, it's dead on the floor. There should be a process set up, and so there's another classic example where the right hand does not know what the left hand is doing.
One more question. Yeah.
Hi, Cammie. I'm an SSP student.
Ah, fine. You're an SSP student. I didn't think anybody was here. Go ahead.
So it seems that public-private partnerships have been really increasingly emphasized for government action. I know I've certainly read a ton of directives increasing public-private partnerships. From your experience, does that popularity have merit? Do they tend to be more effective, or do you think decentralization is becoming too much?
Well, how do you define public-private partnerships? Is that?
I guess from what I understand, it's the government's doing a project in collaboration with an NGO or with a research institute, or is contracting with bond, or that.
Yeah, there's contracts, and there's a lot of contract, and the government may unfortunately contract out too much. But then there are these partnerships or arrangements, which in essence, they basically give all the money, and you're essentially setting up a surrogate U.S. government operation. And I don't know if it works or doesn't. We're looking at that. But it is clear that when you do something that, you have to make certain you have oversight, because you're basically giving a lot of money, a lot of authority, and a lot of responsibility to these private entities. Now, I'm not a critic of many of the NGOs. I think I have been really impressed, and every time I go to Afghanistan, and every time my door is wide open for NGOs to come in, and I think a lot of smaller NGOs, some of the smaller projects, have been excellent, and maybe sometimes smaller may be better in the long run. But the thought of this, these larger grants, these larger arrangements, they're not new. They've been around in other parts of the country. They're very big in Afghanistan. And to be honest with you, our concern with them is really the oversight. Does the government, when they come into this arrangement, are they making certain they can see how the money is being spent? And that's one issue we have not talked about, and that is just access to all of these contracts and arrangements and money in the future. because physically the U.S. citizens, the U.S. government employees, will not be able to see more than 10, 15, 20% of the country in the future because of security situations. So how do you monitor all that money?
You know, this isn't the most uplifting tale in the world.
Oh, I'm upbeat.
I'm trying to think of how many countries in the world create an independent, high-level organization that goes out to seek the truth.
You're absolutely correct. You're
absolutely a little late sometimes. I mean, sometimes we don't, you know, we rush into something and then later on we figure out, oh, we don't know what's really going on here. But, you know, there's so many truths that get buried out there.
And Afi, you are so correct. And I actually told this once to some senior mucky yuck at the State Department. Was all upset because, you know, we were doing a report that was attacking rule of law and the way they were doing it. And I said, now hold on. One second. You are trying and you are spending billions of dollars trying to teach the Afghans about rule of law. And one of the components is transparency. And you want me to classify my report so the American citizens can't see how their money's being spent. I said, is there a disconnect here? Why don't you take my report, go over to the ministries in Kabul, and go to the press? Because there is a growing independent press in Afghanistan. Give them the report and say, look it. This is the way we do things. We're not afraid of having an independent inspector general look at our work. And you shouldn't either. And that, we went back to an area to correct this problem, is to support the independent press, the independent organizations and NGOs that the Afghans have set up. There we can get a bigger bang for the buck, to be honest with you.
Okay. Enough.
I'll answer questions in there.
Yeah, grab him over a glass of wine. Stop it. Thanks so much for coming over.
It's been a pleasure.